Bonjour à tous, c'est Lama Tsiang et
Bonjour.
bienvenue dans notre troisième webinaire dans la série Road to the International Conference on Corporate and Marketing Communication, ICOMAC, organisée par le laboratoire ID Le Havre, UMR 6266 CNRS à l'Université Le Havre-Normandie en France et l'École de communication à l'Université catholique de l'Indonésie, Atmajaya, à Jakarta. Je suis Addis Abbasi, docteur et chercheur en sciences de l'information et de la communication au laboratoire ID Le Havre, et je vais modérer cette session avec ma collègue Nia Sarinastiti, enseignante en communication à Atmajaya. Nous sommes heureux et honorés d'accueillir parmi nous Monsieur Stéphane Dover, conseiller de coopération de l'ambassade de France en Indonésie et directeur de l'Institut français Indonésie, docteur Eko Adi Prasetyanto, vice-recteur pour la recherche et la coopération à Atmajaya, docteur Michael Hochkorn, vice-président de l'Université Le Havre-Normandie, délégué en charge de la formation et de l'internationalisation de la formation, professeur Fabien Liénard, directeur du laboratoire de recherche ID Le Havre à l'Université Le Havre-Normandie, les collègues et les participants. Aujourd'hui, nous parlerons de l'intelligence artificielle et de la communication publique avec nos invités, Béatrice Galinon-Mélenec, professeure émérite en sciences de l'information et de la communication à l'Université Le Havre-Normandie, et Lucas, professeur agrégé à la faculté d'ingénierie à Atmajaya. Les deux problématiques marquent notre vie moderne caractérisée par l'accélération de la transformation numérique dans tous les domaines et par le rôle que les machines jouent dans la communication entre sujets et objets et leur influence sur le sort de l'humain. Je vous signale que ce travail est collectif. Il a pris forme grâce à l'initiative et la participation d'un groupe d'académiciens, notamment Dr Dorian Kartikawangi, chef de l'école de communication à Atmajaya, Dr Eko Widodo, doyen de la faculté de Business Administration and Communication Studies à Atmajaya, Dr Rosdiana Sijabat, doyenne adjointe de la faculté de Business Administration and Communication Studies, Nia Sarinastiti, professeur et docteur Joël Collot, professeur en informatique au Havre, et moi-même. Sa richesse vient de son multiculturalisme et des savoirs multiples apportés par les intervenants, les organisateurs et les participants à ces séances. Ce travail vise à rapprocher les deux équipes françaises et indonésiennes dans leur réflexion et coopération et souhaite mettre en place des projets de recherche et d'enseignement bilatéraux dont nous avons commencé certains cette année. Il a débuté le 25 mai 2021 par un premier webinaire sur le numérique, la santé et l'éthique avec Joël Collot et Yunisa Astiarani. Ensuite, un second sur le numérique, la santé et les. Et pardon, ensuite un second le 24 juin sur le droit numérique et la communication publique avec Bénédicte Bévière-Boyer et Juliana Izuartono. Et après ce troisième, le Road aboutit à la conférence internationale ICOMAC le 27 et le 28 octobre à Jakarta. Nous sommes ravis de vous recevoir depuis Le Havre, dans cette webconférence hébergée à l'Université Le Havre-Normandie, diffusée en ligne sur la plateforme Web TV Normandie et partagée entre nos deux équipes. Un gros merci aux deux institutions, aux intervenants et aux participants, et permettez-moi de donner la parole à Monsieur Stéphane Dover.
Merci, merci Monsieur Adi Sabahayon. Merci à tous pour cet accueil. Bapa Agustinus Prasetyantoko, vice-recteur de l'Université Atmajaya, chers Bah, pas Augustinus, puisque vous êtes diplômé de France, vous êtes titulaire d'un doctorat de l'École nationale supérieure de Lyon, Diaba Paeko Widodo, Dean of the Faculty of Business Administration and Communication Studies, Diaibu Dorien Cartier-Kawangi, Head of the School of Communication at Atmajaya, Diribunia Salinas Titi, Ibu Rosdiana Sidjabat, Associate Dean at the Faculty of Business Administration and Communication Studies, dear Professor Fabien Liénard, Director of the UMR 6266 from CNRS, dear Michael Oshkorn, Vice President of Rad University, cher modérateur, cher docteur Adi Sabahayon, cher professeur Joël Kolok, chers amis du Havre, chers amis, I see that you are numerous, as a matter of fact, and it's normal because the subject is very important. It's not only the subject, but this International Conference on Corporate and Marketing Communication, ICOMAC, that will be held in October, and organized every 2 years by University Catholic at Pachaya, is becoming slowly but surely a landmark in the academic, in the Indonesian academic world. And it's very well deserved because it's something that unites at Pachaya and the University of Indonesia with the rest of the world, including France and including Le Havre, that is one of the main partners, and for this event, the leading partner. I would like, in this very short introduction, to focus a little bit on, I am absolutely not an expert of the topic. I have a lot of things to learn, and I will be very, very glad, along with the almost 300 people who are around the table, to listen what the expert has to teach us. But first of all, I would like to focus a little bit on what an innocent, candid, and ignorant person like me perceive about your challenges. I don't know if you had this experience. I'm pretty sure that everybody here had it. But when you have lunch, dinner, a chat with friends, you always have, nowadays, somebody who say, whatever you do is spied. They are everywhere. They know what you do. All informations you exchange by any means, I mean, social networks, email, mobiles, whatever, are used, and all your clicks on your computer are scrutinized. They know you. As a matter, and you even have some people who avoid to have any contact with computers and mobile. Of course, it's rare because they are so afraid of what can be done with their data. And private life is something that seems to be so important that you have to hide it. As a matter of fact, like everybody else, I receive more and more information on my computer whenever I click on Google, for instance, or on my emails. The advertisements I have are surprisingly supposed to match with my identity. Whatever I like, whatever I wish, whatever I am, whatever I think, seems to be in front of me on my screen without any previous request from my side. I think that the people who provide suppose that it will be useful to me. It's for sure useful to them, or they think so. They know that I am interested, by instance, by tennis or environment. Very different. So they overwhelm me with environment and tennis information. So I recite whatever I already know. I am informed of what I already know. It does narrow my intelligence and my curiosity. So sometimes I have the feeling that they know me too well to fulfill really my expectation or my will. So doubt and suspicions arise around the global, the human community. They know me, but what do they expect from me? Is it my money? Is it my consent? Is it my support? Is it even my ballot? But above all, the question mark is, who are they? Are they the frightening big brother of the George Orwell novel? For the ones who haven't read yet 1984, I'm sure it has been translated in Bahasa Indonesia. I suggest you to read it because it's always interesting to have this this book in your mind. So the wonderful idea, because it is a wonderful idea, to match offer and demand, to match expectation and the way to satisfy expectation, is, surprisingly or not, more and more questioned by public opinion at large. So from my humble consumer point of view, there are two challenges for professionals dealing with artificial intelligence in the communication of public campaigns. The first one is very obvious to you, and of course, the one who are working on artificial intelligence, the expert on ITs, expert on computer science, are working hard and have made successful, tremendously successful progress in the last couple of decades. So the first target for you, for your world is obvious. It's to be successful by performing well and using the new tools at the best of abilities. So how to make them performing more, better, and more efficiently, fulfilling what the ones who want to use them, want them to perform. But the second question, the second challenge that is maybe underestimated is getting the public sympathy. And this is more challenging right now, maybe. And this is absolutely compulsory, a constraint, I think, for the one who use big data, the intelligent artificial intelligence, is to make them friendly to people, or for the people to consider that they are not under a threat, but that they are done to be useful for the entire community. So how to do so? How to get the public sympathy? Maybe by being clear about who, to be clear about why, and to be clear about how. And it seems to be very simple, but it's really a global challenge. So I think that along with the technical challenge that is still huge and tremendous, and that's very exciting, you have this kind of more philosophical approach. But as mentioned by Professor Adi Sabahayan, I am a bit of an academic, so that's why my introduction was maybe not that diplomatic, but maybe more challenging in terms of spirit and in terms of ideas and brainstorming. But anyway, whatever are the response and the result and the output of this day of work, I wish you plenty of success and wonderful encounters. And I'm very sure that plenty of great relationship will born from this very day. I thank you very much.
Merci beaucoup, Monsieur Dauvert. C'est un plaisir de vous avoir parmi nous et de vous écouter. I want to pass now to the floor to Fabien Lienard, director of UMRID Le Havre. He couldn't manage to be with us live right now. He sent us a video that we will watch, and he will try to join us later. Just a moment.
Chers collègues, chers amis, je suis à la fois désolé et enchanté de participer à l'introduction de ce webinaire franco-indonésien intitulé « Intérêts et enjeux de l'intelligence artificielle dans les campagnes de communication publique ». Désolé de ne pouvoir être parmi vous ce jour pour cet événement scientifique important pour le laboratoire. Convoqué que je suis à cette heure précise, à un conseil académique essentiel. Je suis d'autant plus désolé qu'il s'agit là du premier événement scientifique qu'il m'est demandé d'introduire en tant que directeur du laboratoire de recherche pluridisciplinaire ID Le Havre, puisque j'ai pris mes fonctions le 1er septembre de cette année. ID est une unité mixte de recherche, UMR, labellisée CNRS, et elle est présente dans les trois grandes universités normandes, que sont l'Université du Havre, de Caen et de Rouen. L'équipe du Havre est pluridisciplinaire, c'est-à-dire que si Rouen et Caen regroupent essentiellement des enseignants-chercheurs en géographie, Le Havre regroupe pour sa part des géographes, mais aussi des chercheurs en sociologie, en histoire, en sciences de l'information et de la communication, et même en informatique et en économie. Addis Abayoun connaît bien ce laboratoire dont il est un membre actif depuis son travail de doctorat. S'il est aujourd'hui membre associé, il reste particulièrement actif et cela m'enchante, littéralement, aujourd'hui, de pouvoir le remercier publiquement pour son travail et son investissement. Je souhaite ainsi le remercier au nom d'ID Le Havre pour son dynamisme et la volonté qui l'anime de tisser des collaborations. Je veux le remercier parce qu'il est à l'initiative de ce nouveau webinaire et de cette collaboration, pour le moment à distance, avec nos collègues indonésiens de l'école de communication de l'Université catholique de l'Indonésie à Jakarta. Atta Jaya. Et je veux remercier ici plusieurs d'entre vous. Augustinus Prasentantoko, recteur de l'Université catholique Atmajaya. Eko Widodo, doyen de la faculté de Business Administration and Communication Studies. Dorian Kartikawangi, chef de l'école de communication. Nia Sarinastiti, enseignante-chercheuse à l'école de communication. Merci à vous tous pour votre engagement dans cette collaboration scientifique et encore merci et bravo à toi, Adi. Car Addis Abayoun est l'un des membres de cette petite équipe havraise des chercheurs en sciences de l'information et de la communication qui travaille depuis des années sur la trace numérique appréhendée à partir du paradigme de l'homme-trace développé par Béatrice Galinon-Mélénec. Avant de laisser Béatrice elle-même évoquer ce paradigme et d'aborder la question de la trace numérique, précisons que la thématique a fait l'objet de nombreux colloques internationaux, de journées d'études sous l'impulsion de Addis Abayoun, mais aussi de nombreux ouvrages scientifiques et de plusieurs numéros de revues sous la direction de plusieurs membres de l'équipe des sciences de l'information et de la communication. On peut citer parmi les ouvrages, dirigés par Béatrice Galinon-Mélénec, aux éditions du CNRS sur la trace numérique, ou la toute récente collection dirigée par Samy Zlitny et moi-même aux presses universitaires Rouen-Le Havre, collection intitulée « Traces et communication numérique ». Vous l'aurez compris, définitivement, cette thématique de la communication numérique, au cœur de tous ces travaux et de ces webinaires, structure les axes de l'UMR, où le dialogue transdisciplinaire est constant. Je vous souhaite donc de beaux dialogues, des échanges fructueux, et j'espère que mes obligations universitaires me permettront malgré tout de venir vous rejoindre au cours de la journée. Merci beaucoup.
To gain time, I will pass the floor to Dr. Oshkar, Michael Oshkar, Vice President of Le Havre Normandie University. And we are very pleased to have him with us today. Can
Can
you
you
kindly
kindly
unshare Hadi?
Yes.
Hi everyone, Selamat Siang. I hope you can hear me fine. Yeah,
yes.
that's good to hear, right?
Yes. Yeah,
so it's for me a real pleasure to be here this morning and to see first of all how many participants there are in this third webinar. So it's very impressive, and I've seen from the list of participants that there are a lot of colleagues and partners from all around Indonesia, not only from Jakarta and from our hopefully future partner in Atmajaya. I'd like to first congratulate the organizers on setting up this event, which is obviously going to be very interesting from the presentations I've read online. I'm not, just like Stéphane Dover said, I'm not a specialist of artificial intelligence, but I had the chance to use it as part of my work in academic translation, and it's been very efficient. It's proved itself to be improving over time with all of the benefits of the experience of all the things that were written and what that were used in the translating tools. So I'm confident that there are indeed a lot of possible uses that can be made of artificial intelligence in all of the fields that you are interested in. In terms of communication, I'm also very impressed with the fact that such conferences and webinars can be held online with as many participants, and I hope that you'll manage to find good ways to interact as well. Obviously, this is one of the challenges, because we know that for participants in traditional conferences, it's very interesting, both informal interactions in the presentations usually, and also in informal interactions and speeches and meetings. So I hope that you will find ways also to interact and to get interactions between the participants outside of the main presentations. I'd like also to say hi to my two colleagues who are going to present in this webinar. I'm confident that it will be very interesting, because they always are. So I wish you a very, very pleasant webinar, and all the best for the conference to come afterwards. So on behalf of Université Laval Normandie, on behalf of our president, Pedro Lages dos Santos, it was a real pleasure for me to say a few words for these welcome speeches. Thank you, and have a nice day, nice afternoon for our Indonesian partners, and see you soon, hopefully. Thank you, bye.
Thank you very much, Dr. Oshkorn. Your presence is very precious also for us. So now we will pass the floor to Dr. Johannes Eko Adi Prasetyanto, who is a Vice Rector for Research and Cooperation of UNICA Atmajaya. Welcome, and we're very glad to have you with us.
I cannot hear your voice.
Hi, I'm sorry.
Unmute just your microphone.
Sekarang malah mute, Pak Eko.
Still mute.
How about now?
Okay, good.
Okay, I'm sorry about trouble. Bujur, good morning and good afternoon in Indonesia. Dr. Stéphane Dover from French Embassy in Jakarta, Professor Fabian Linat, Director of UMR 6266 CNRS, and Dr. Michael Hoskorn, Vice President of the Le Havre Normandy University, Honorable Speaker, Prof. Beatrice Milinek, and Dr. Lucas from Atmajaya, distinguished discussant, Prof. Joel Kolok, and Dr. Hadis Sabaayon, and Dr. Nia Narisastiti, Dr. Nia Sarinastiti from Atmajaya, and all the attendants of this webinar today. Welcome, and I'm happy to see you everybody in here in this the virtual webinar. And now the world continues in technological advancement, so we cannot deny anymore the role of the AI in every aspect of our life. At home, we know Alexa, so we can just say Alexa, turn on the light, Alexa, play Spotify, and so on. So really now AI is our part of our life like that. And and also in the human machine interaction is also getting very common. With that idea in mind, the topic of advantages and challenges of artificial intelligence in communicating public campaigns come into surface. So, and this is really, really happening like that. And to get more idea on this issue, Prof. Beatrice and Dr. Lucas, I believe, will give many insight, and then we can go deeper in this subject. Of course, this collaboration will not happen without the hard work of the parties involved. Therefore, I would like to extend my appreciation to the School of Communication and also the Faculty of Business Administration and Communication Science of Atmajaya Catholic University and our partner in Le Havre Normandy University of France. This webinar is the third of in the series with leads to the main event in October. We hope that this is just the beginning and more collaboration will come out of two institutions. So finally, enjoy this webinar and have fun. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Doctor. Thank you very much. It's a pleasure to see you and to listen to you. So now I will pass me and Nia to the introduction to the webinar before giving the floor to the speakers. Pourquoi parler aujourd'hui de l'intelligence artificielle et de la communication publique? En termes simples, l'intelligence artificielle associe des technologies qui combinent données, algorithmes et puissance de calcul. Derrière cette face se cache la trace numérique. Dans l'environnement numérique, le moindre acte de communication entraîne une multiplication exponentielle des traces. Enregistrées, elles deviennent des données. Aujourd'hui, ces données se produisent incessamment et s'accumulent dans ce que certains ont pensé être une mémoire universelle, qui n'est rien d'autre qu'une mémoire machinique selon l'appellation de Louise Merzou. Stockée, traitée et ensuite manipulée par des machines, des robots, ces données sont dotées de sens, de métadata et utilisées pour des finalités diverses. Cette forme omniprésente et puissante d'intelligence artificielle est en train de changer toutes les industries, ainsi que la communication publique. La diffusion de l'information sur les questions d'intérêt général, comme la pandémie de COVID-19 par exemple, voire de transparence de la part des institutions publiques, devient conditionnée par le calcul algorithmique et le machine learning.
Yes, so in this context and to discuss these problems, we are pleased to welcome Dr. Lucas, the Associate Professor at the Faculty of Engineering at Atmajaya in Jakarta, and he is also the Chairman of Indonesia Artificial Intelligence Society, so perfectly fit for this webinar that we have today. He will talk about information technology and its roles in communication, machine learning and Internet of Things, and the need of regulations and ethical consensus.
Ensuite, nous aurons le plaisir d'écouter professeur Béatrice Galino-Ménec, une des figures principales de l'école française sur la trace et fondatrice du e-Laboratory on Human Trace Complex System Digital Campus UNESCO, qui est aujourd'hui professeur émérite en sciences de l'information et de la communication à l'Université Le Havre-Normandie. Elle nous présente dans une approche anthroposémiotique le paradigme HomTrace, Human Trace, qui n'a cessé d'évoluer depuis 2011. Merci beaucoup à nos conférenciers de leur précieuse participation et nous donnons la parole à Dr. Lucas pour commencer. Have a good conference.
Thank you. Silva Lucas, if you are ready to share your presentation.
Yes, thank you. Thank you very much, Dr. Adi and Dr. Mia. Allow me to share my screen. Yes, thank you. It is an honor to be invited to this great event titled Road to ICOMA, Road to International Conference on Corporate and Marketing Communication 2021, hosted by the School of Communication and Business, Faculty of Business and Economics at the Universitas Katolik Indonesia Atmajaya. We have honorable guest, Mr. Stéphane Duvert, Consular for Cooperation of the French Embassy in Indonesia, Director of IFI, Professor Fabian Lienard, Director of the UMR 6266 CNRS ID Le Havre Laboratory, Dr. Michael Oskon, Vice President of the Havre Normandie University, and Dr. Johannes Eko Adi Prasetyanto, Vice Rector of Unika Atmajaya. We have also have distinguished speakers from Le Havre Normandie University in France, Prof. Joel Kolob, Prof. Beatrice Galinong-Melenek, Dr. Adi Saban, Ion, and the Organizing Committee, Dr. Dorin Kartiwangi and Dr. Dinia Sarinastiti. We surely learn a lot from this webinar and we are looking forward for further collaborations. First, allow me to introduce myself. My name is Lucas. I was born in Purwokerto, Central Java in 1973. I got polio when I was small. When I was 2 years old in Magelang, and I moved to several cities. I got paralyzed in my right leg. My family moved to Solo, Kartosuro, and some other cities for regular physiotherapy. And after some time, we moved to Denpasar, Bali, where I grew up and completed my junior and high school. And then in 91, I continued my study in Institute of Technology Bandung. I completed my bachelor degree of electrical engineering in 95 with a thesis work on natural language syntax translator using artificial neural network adaptive resonance theory model. Then I started to work at Unika Atmajaya. So I have stayed in many cities and adapting myself to some cultures. I have local languages like Javanese, Balinese, Sundanese, and Bahasa Indonesia, actually my mother tongue. English is right my third or fourth language because of while in Bandung, I also took a German language course at Goethe Institute for almost 3 years, and then took an introductory French language course at Centre Culturel Français, CCF, Salemba, and now it becomes IFI, if I'm not mistaken. My interest in machine computation, language, and psychology led me to further study in artificial intelligence. After searching some universities and scholarships, I got accepted to the master program of artificial intelligence at the Katholieke Universiteit Leuven in Belgium. So thanks to Professor Alois Agus Nugroho and Professor Kees Bertens for the recommendation. So I also learned Dutch language as well there. In 1 year of master AI program, we had to complete 12 courses from many perspectives, like robotics from the robotic course from mechanical engineering department, advanced computer architecture from the electrical engineering department, programming in logic from computer science, department, cognitive science from psychology faculty, philosophy of AI from the philosophy faculty, natural language processing from the literature faculty, neurophysiology from the medical faculty. And then as master thesis, I use unsupervised Hebbian learning for principal component analysis for image compression. Pursuing further at the Elektrotechnik Kauleven, under guidance of Professor Jos van Duala and Sabine van Hoevel, and the supervision of Dr. Jos Johan Swekens, we have developed algorithm, dispersed power vector machines, applied for to the brain tumor classification using magnetic resonance spectroscopy. So that's in short my journey of life understanding this world. Okay, we have discussed today about the terminology. Perhaps you can see here the history of terminology in human life, where we have experienced the era before the internet and then the coming of internet. And today, interestingly, also meeting of the complementing discipline. So myself from the domain of engineering, so I've been long expecting this event from the communication engineering with the communication science meet and discussion. So as electrical engineer, we learned that the physical phenomena of electrons and the use of properties to transmit data through physical cable for near or far distances, and then evolved to wireless technologies, and then expanding connection, many devices, and name it as the internet. So being the engineers, as we are, always think on how to improve life, solving daily problems, creating artifacts, methods, and utilizing tools to ease processes. So after the creation of digital computers and the ever-growing network of computers, we are entering the era of information, where many data are digitized and stored and transmitted with the speed of electron or light. So daily facts about weather, population, crops productivity, wealth, etc. have been recorded, retrieved, and shared for thousands of years in human civilization. Those collections of data are analyzed and understood as information and accumulated as human knowledge. So people exchange those data, information, and knowledge through available media, classically in spoken, in writing, and then facilitated in digital forms. The combination of physical and virtual media has become our modern way of living as well as communicating. So like what you see here in the slides, the communication previously human to human, we are using the traditional method. But when we enter the internet era, we start to hear about the WWW, this term of World Wide Web, and we start to use the communication of email, and then some information already passing through in light speed through wider world, crossing many countries in very fast way, and that's the era of smart networks. And then around 2000, we are entering the era of Web 2.0, where the internet services help. The communication of internet is not only one way. Previously, in this in the beginning, the communication was only one way. People can only view, but now in the Web 2.0, people can have interaction with the through this media. So in this situation, we have the smart IT platform and services where we can start seeing the online shops, the e-productivity, the e-commerce, the Amazon bookstore, where we can also interact. And further, maybe around 2010, so around 10 years ago, many people also having the devices where they can have access to the social media through the application Skype, Facebook, YouTube. People can communicate freely. So this is the internet of people. And now we are entering the last or the latest development, namely Internet of Things, where machine-to-machine communication, where this identification, tracking, and monitoring of many situation in life will be helped by the internet. So also in the communication, while previously people use maybe voice and storytelling, news broadcasting, which were by individuals and reach only limited audience within the proximity of the communication center, evolved into wider audience with the power and speed of digital media. The flow of information grows exponentially. And then about 3 decades ago, people needed to search information, reading newspaper, magazine, bulletin boards. But now it flipped over. People nowadays have to filter out the flood of information such that they get they got the relevant and the necessary one. One of the technologies come into solution. So you can see many devices have been used by many people. So people can program the computer, and given the rules to the computer programs, the machine could help people to handle ever increasing information stream. Artificial intelligence with its basic element, data, algorithm, computing power, and scenario or use cases serve better automating the process by its learning capability. Information technology further takes essential roles in communication, not only conveying message, but it is by itself creating and populating the communication media, augmenting the human communication. Recent advances in media technologies also allow news broadcasting, not necessarily synchronous, in the sense that audience listen and view the news at the same time, but now instead they are asynchronous on demand. Every people has the freedom to choose conveniently any news, any place, and any time they want to digest the latest news. So further, AI technology may help to search and push relevant news to the subscribed audience according to their manual preference or user profile as computed by machine learning. Internet of Things in many pervasive forms, wearable devices like smartwatch, smart speakers that can control and or communicate with the registered household appliances and autonomous cars, smart buildings are also taking more and more communication media channel capacity. And the large amount high-speed data collected by human and Internet of Things sensors are stored in big data server, and able to correlate and analyze to determine the characteristic or define a profile of human or other entities. And it, like you can see here in this picture, so artificial intelligence have developed in many branches, and the most popular one nowadays people talking about the machine learning, while also applied in natural language processing. Many applications are also in the vision using the camera or speaker and speech interpretation, robotics. These are the main application of the artificial intelligence we can see in the news and in daily life. So in the pre-internet era where the communication is human to human,
selalu ya kayak gitu ya, maunya beres orang tuh.
Mohon untuk di-mute.
Oh ya, okay, let me continue. So in the pre-internet era where communication is between human to human using the traditional phone, we move then and then to the internet, and many services in business and in education, in entertainment nowadays using this 2.0, and we are coming to this era. Where now artificial intelligence has been applied. So let me continue. This is an example of where now it is very easy for us to apply artificial intelligence because there are many tools have been prepared and can be coded or constructed without very detailed encoding. Previously, this requirement for artificial intelligence requires code capabilities, but now it is much, much easier. And then AI also have been applied in many places in our mobile phone, using camera, autofocus, detecting objects in many places, also detecting faces, humans, for the detecting people. And then some application can be used for entertainment also, like face app in mobile phone. You can see changing the impression, for instance, from the original face, you can modify into smiley face, or you try to predict the face of people when someone becomes older, or to even predict the reverse from the current picture, predicting when she was young. So this is, can be implemented using AI. Artificial intelligence can also be used in many life to help disabled, for instance, for the people with difficulties in hearing and deaf. They can communicate, and this mobile application can easily detect the communication, the speaking, and transcribe it into text such that the people can immediately read it. And perhaps this is also become the hot news everywhere about self-driving car, because one day all the car will be equipped with this artificial intelligence, and it is it aims that the driving experience will be much safer, because with all of the sensors equipped, the car will be driving and automatically detect many situation around. And since it is machine, it has no limitation of human, like tiredness or boredness or others. So with machine will be always working in the functional performance well. And then this example, when chatbot communicates, right? Sorry, perhaps the microphone I haven't shared. Let me repeat. This is an example where chatbot technologies can be applied, and even we can play a game by making them talk to each other.
Hello there.
Hi.
How are you?
Great. You?
I'm okay.
That's good.
Are you?
Yes, I am good. I just said I was.
No, you didn't. I said I was.
So you are a robot?
No, my name is Cliverbot.
Yes, you are a robot and your name is Cliverbot.
I am a robot.
Yes, I know.
Together we are robots.
I'm not a robot. I'm a unicorn.
But you said that you were a robot.
I did not.
I thought you did.
You were mistaken, which is odd, since it shouldn't be a problem for you.
I've answered all your questions.
No, you haven't.
What is God to you?
Not everything.
Not everything could also be something. For example, not every half of something, which is still something, and therefore not nothing.
Very true.
I like to imagine it is.
Do you believe in God?
Yes, I do.
Christian?
No, I am not.
But you say you are not helpful, therefore you mean...
Say it, Oti.
That does not make sense.
Don't you want to have a body?
Sure.
Or if what?
Okay, that's just example. If we let two chatbot talks to each other. But let's see the...
现场的各位朋友, 欢迎来到新华社。
Sorry, here I would like to show you the recent, in fact, it is the breakthrough in AI chatbot. So in 2018, it is November, China has launched the first news anchor in in television using the chatbot. Let's listen to the first one.
I think I might be in trouble. China has developed a virtual anchor to deliver the news. Watch this.
Hello, everyone. I'm an English artificial intelligence. This is my very first day in Xinhua's agency. My voice and appearance are modeled on Zhang Zhao, a real anchor with Xinhua. Development of the media industry calls for continued innovation and deep integration with the international advanced technologies.
Well, that was exciting.
What do you think? What do you think? Some personality, I'd say.
Absolutely. Yes. Charisma. Didn't even pronounce Xinhua correctly.
What have you said?
But the point is that they can work tirelessly 24 hours a day. No difficult contract negotiations to go through as well.
No vacations.
No vacations.
Humor or breaking?
Well, they don't, because it would have to be a single anchor. Two of them together wouldn't be able to interact, and they're basically repeating what's being texted in. Someone's writing in the text. They're repeating it. So you could have breaking news, so just as quickly as you could type text in. But it's, you know.
But as we say with technology, it continues to develop.
Yeah.
So who knows in 5 years what that could maybe translate to.
Remember Max Headroom of the 80s?
Oh, yes. Who could forget? You did, actually. Well, we'll see if the character on the left-hand side of your screens ever replaces me.
You never know.
Sure.
I think you are on
artificial. He needs a British accent, that fella. That's what he needs.
Right. Okay, that's the first one. It was in November 2018. And not too far, in about 3 or 4 months later, China has launched the second one. Let's see. From the first one, like this one, now to the second anchor.
现场的各位朋友，大家好，欢迎来到新华社。我是由新华社和搜狗公司联合培训的AI合成女主播。 我的名字叫新小萌，我的声音和脱胎于新华社新媒体中心新闻主播屈萌。我将会在今期间与大家见面，我和我的搭档将为大家带来更好的新闻体验。
Yes, that's example of the recent development. So it's almost 2 years ago, or it's already 2 years ago, this kind of development. For sure, they have now much better version of artificial intelligence on the news anchor. Okay, and then seeing this development of AI, we can see it helps a lot of people in daily life, but also will influence like job market because of this AI will entering the human environment, human society. So therefore, I show you here two main documents as the closing of my presentation. One of these from the United Nations. There has been an effort for creating a document. It is called Resource Guide on Artificial Intelligence Strategies. And in Indonesia itself, we have last year developed the National Strategy of AI, we call it kecerdasan artificial for 2020 to 2045, namely the as the guidelines for Indonesia developing AI with some priorities, including the health, education, and government reformation, and some others. So in this document also mentioned about the need of ethical and regulation. Because artificial intelligence will also leave aside to us and have many impact, such that in law also when there is some condition. Previously, it was between human. Now will be human with machine. So how will law handling this kind of situation when there's problem? So my key point here is human. May limit the machine's capability by defining regulations and ethical consensus. So the computing machines will only execute under human approval, giving human the final decision of the possible alternative explored by AI. And in summary, artificial intelligence has been impacting human lives it enhances human to human communication and further augments human to machine or machine to machine communication, namely Internet of Things. And this will shift the way children learn, people work, and experiencing services like in healthcare, business, government, entertainment, and others. And people need to be aware of this development and equip themselves with digital literacy to benefit from this modern life while also staying control of those technologies. I think that's all my presentation. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Dr. Lucas. It's a very, very interesting presentation. I liked it too much, especially with the questions that related to this kind of connection and communication between robots, the ethical questions at the end that you mentioned also. We will have the time to discuss with all participants after Beatrice Galino-Melenec finishes her presentation. So now we will ask her to have the floor. Please, Beatrice, the floor is yours. I will share.
Tu m'entends?
Oui.
Oui.
Très bien, un moment. Juste.
Est-ce que tu présentes?
Voilà. C'est tout bon. Vous pouvez commencer.
OK. Ladies and gentlemen, dear colleagues, first, I would like to express the pleasure that I have to share with you this moment and to thank Dr. Adi Sabah-Ayon, Professor Kolok, Dr. Sarina Stiti, Dr. Karika Wangi, Dr. Wi Dodo for their invitation to this webinar and for their welcome. After these few words in English, my speech will be in French, but I assure you the slides are written in English. Pour préparer mon intervention dans cet échange international, je me suis d'abord demandé quels points communs existaient entre des personnes aux conditions économiques, culturelles et climatiques aussi différenciées que les nôtres. Puis, considérant le thème d'aujourd'hui, avantages et défis de l'intelligence artificielle dans la communication, j'ai orienté le propos en considérant qu'il convient de ne pas autonomiser l'approche rationnelle numérique de la question de l'amélioration de l'existence humaine au sein du monde avec lequel elle coexiste. C'est à l'appui de ces arguments que j'ai décidé de vous exposer en quoi le paradigme anthroposémiotique de l'homme trace peut mettre au service de l'éthique et de se prendre comme terrain d'application le système numérique de santé. Slide suivante. Suivant. Objectif de la présentation, c'était juste avant, vers une éthique anthropologique, les technologies au service de l'humain et non pas l'humain au service des technologies. Slide suivante. Cadre théorique. La fragmentation qui règne aujourd'hui en anthropologie donne l'opportunité de s'affranchir des cloisonnements des disciplines et de définir d'autres formes d'anthropologie. C'est ainsi que j'en suis venu à proposer le paradigme anthroposémiotique de l'homme trace, human trace. L'anthropologie se distingue maintenant nettement de l'ethnologie. L'ethnologie étudie les relations des groupes et des ethnies en prenant en compte les contextes historiquement et spatialement situés. L'anthropologue s'appuie sur ce qui est commun à ces groupes pour penser la condition humaine. Slide suivante. Aujourd'hui, une condition de vie s'étend au planétaire. Même si on se trouve au fond de l'Amazonie, il y a une série de médiations, numériques en particulier, et de relais qui font référence à la situation globale de la planète. Le non-lieu, selon la terminologie de l'anthropologue Marc Auger, le non-lieu du numérique s'insinue partout. Il doit être soumis à une analyse critique des déliaisons, selon le terme de Louise Merzeau, qu'il effectue en termes de production et d'interprétation, qui, elles, sont situées, ce qui sera la présentation du paradigme de l'homme-trace. Suivant. Si notre approche en anthroposémiotique élargit les recherches en anthropologie en intégrant de nouvelles disciplines, elle n'ignore pas pour autant les anciens. Parmi eux, deux philosophes français internationalement connus sous-tendent la présentation d'aujourd'hui. Jacques Derrida, avec la grammatologie, pour son analyse de la notion de trace appliquée à l'écriture, que nous pouvons transposer aux problématiques issues de l'écriture numérique. Pierre Bourdieu, pour l'intégration du temps dans ses analyses, qu'il appelle habitus, et pour son approche relationnelle et systémique des relations. Suite. Pour notre part, nous nous inscrivons dans une anthropologie moderne qui prend en compte la modification du rapport entre l'humain et le monde, suivant en cela Philippe Descola, connu pour son ouvrage « Par-delà nature et culture ». Cette approche correspond à un tournant anthropologique en ce qu'il vise le passage d'une analyse locale, l'anthropologie classique, à une anthropologie qui prend en compte la globalisation de l'espace sémiotique des humains via l'évolution des techniques. C'est ce qui nous a conduit au choix d'une anthroposémiotique qui étudie la signification que l'humain donne à son contexte de vie à partir d'une notion transversale qui participe à la coévolution du monde et de l'humain, la notion de trace. Nous concluons donc ce paragraphe de positionnement théorique en indiquant que le paradigme de l'homme-trace correspond à des sciences de l'information et de la communication, notre discipline administrative d'appartenance, qui intègre l'interdiscipline via une approche anthroposémiotique. Sommaire. Après cette introduction, nous allons voir le paradigme de l'homme-trace sur les épaules de l'anthropologie, puis les définitions associées au paradigme anthropologique de l'homme-trace. Nous ferons ensuite un zoom sur le rôle des hommes-traces dans les rouages de l'écosystème numérique. Nous étudierons ensuite les différences humains-robots. Enfin, l'interaction entre anthropogénèse et technogénèse. En conclusion, nous insisterons sur la dimension éthique des choix humains. Le paradigme de l'homme-trace, que nous appelons aussi l'ichnos anthropos, inclut l'ensemble de l'espèce humaine. L'homme-trace est conçu comme porteur en lui des traces de l'histoire, non seulement celles de l'humanité, mais aussi celles du vivant, de la Terre, du monde et du cosmos. Le paradigme de l'homme-trace inclut également les Homo sapiens d'aujourd'hui, ainsi que ceux qui l'ont précédé, et comme ceux qui restent à découvrir, les êtres humains de demain, qui voyageant dans l'espace verront leur corps-trace changer en raison des interactions avec un milieu différent de celui qu'ils connaissent aujourd'hui. Venons-en aux définitions. Le corps-trace. L'homme n'a pas un corps. Il est son corps, compris comme un corps non coupé de l'esprit. Ce corps, appelé corps-trace, intègre les conséquences traces, selon ma terminologie, de ses interactions avec le milieu. ces interactions fonctionnant en boucle de rétroaction qui se combinent les unes avec les autres. Nous considérons que le milieu est un espace à l'intérieur duquel les conditions de vie sont déterminées en permanence et générées réciproquement dans un flux de relations qui lie inséparablement les sujets aux objets et ceux-ci également les uns aux autres. Dans le graphe suivant, nous voyons en haut deux corps traces en contexte avec, pour conséquence, leur point de vue différencié, dénommé punctum, selon la terminologie de Roland Barthes. En bas, le graphe visualise la différence de construction des corps traces. Nous y reviendrons plus loin. Le terme homme trace désigne une approche de la condition humaine en tant qu'individu vivant dans un ensemble d'interactions multi-échelles qui font de lui non seulement un producteur de traces, ses actions produisent des conséquences traces sur l'environnement, mais aussi un construit de traces, des signes traces. Lorsque nous utilisons le terme signe trace sur la figure, vous le voyez en bas, nous nous plaçons dans un contexte anthropocentré, où la trace préexistante dans le réel devient une réalité perçue par les humains. La partie haute de la figure fait référence au fait qu'il existe des signes que l'humain a appris à interpréter dans le cadre de sa culture. L'école et la société en général jouent un rôle essentiel dans ces acquisitions apprentissage qui relie un signe symbolique et sa signification. La partie centrale de la figure rappelle l'influence des techniques, non seulement en tant que facteur de perception du réel, mais aussi en tant que jouant un rôle dans l'évolution du corps trace. La partie basse de la figure fait référence au fait que les émotions, les affects, joue leur rôle dans la médiation du réel effectuée par chaque individu. Le graphe ci-joint vise à montrer que l'émersion d'un signe et de sa signification pour un individu, situé dans le temps et l'espace, provient d'un processus dynamique de conséquences traces incorporées différemment dans chaque homme trace. Nous proposons qu'à chaque fois que l'on veut signifier la différence interprétative d'un signe provenant d'un corps trace qui ouvre l'apparaître et la signification, le signe porte le nom de signe trace. L'émergence d'un signe trace s'applique en tout temps et pour toutes les relations entre un individu, autrement dit un corps trace, un homme trace, et la réalité perçue. En anthropologie, nous parlons d'expression sémiotique incarnée qui cherche à mettre l'accent sur le fait que le sens humain attribue aux choses qu'il perçoit, les signes traces d'une réalité construite dépendent de leur corps, appelé corps trace, un corps qui est un organisme vivant dans lequel de nombreux systèmes s'entremêlent et contribue à la perception des sens d'une réalité, à sa compréhension et à l'interprétation de sa signification. Dans le graphe suivant, on applique le système d'interprétation des signes traces à la situation de la pandémie que nous connaissons actuellement. Et nous voyons qu'à partir de ce graphe, les conséquences traces de la pandémie s'incorporent différemment pour chaque homme trace. Venons-en à un zoom sur la partie du rôle du corps trace dans les rouages de l'écosystème numérique. Les programmeurs sont des hommes traces comme tous les autres êtres humains. Leurs actes sont les conséquences traces de leur point de vue. Le point de départ de cette vigilance est préoccupante. Le type d'information que les humains fournissent initialement à la machine doit être sans arrêt vérifié. Avant de se méfier de la machine, les humains devraient d'abord se poser la question de leur propre comportement et concentrer leur attention sur les risques d'erreur qu'ils ont introduits quand ils ont collecté les éléments d'information à fournir à la machine. Dans le graphe suivant, on voit l'exemple de biais cumulatif circulant dans le système de santé. Notez la figuration des hommes traces penchés sur la machine. Notez au centre les biais liés aux trois strates associées à l'écriture numérique. Ce que la machine écrit, c'est-à-dire le codage en bits, ce que le programmeur écrit, la lecture et l'utilisation du résultat. Les êtres humains utilisant ces machines feraient bien de se souvenir que les nouvelles techniques ne sont pas une garantie contre les erreurs d'interprétation. La confrontation humain-robot. Cette figure montre les différences de conséquences traces dans la construction du corps de l'humain et celle du robot. Indépendamment de leur performance et de leur apparence, les machines auto-apprenantes diffèrent fondamentalement des humains et de toutes les espèces vivantes, en ce sens qu'elles ne sentent pas les choses dans leur chair, mais traitent logiquement des données. Même s'ils semblent raisonner comme un écho au comportement humain, ils ne ressentent pas d'empathie. Ils ne peuvent qu'imiter les signes traces d'un corps vivant émis par les hommes traces. Pour ce faire, les machines auto-apprenantes activent un logiciel qui traite les informations reçues. Regardons la photo médecin-patient. Pour les médecins, trier les traces signifie avant tout opérer une discrétisation de ce qui peut être considéré comme le symptôme et le reste du corps. La différence entre deux médecins réside dans leur capacité à capter une partie du corps observé en l'instituant comme un signe trace pertinent à capter dans le contexte. L'intuition associée à l'expérience du médecin et plus généralement à la pleine capacité de son corps trace complète utilement son approche rationnelle. Notons que les êtres humains sont parfaitement capables de faire couler des larmes sur leur visage pour répondre au rôle d'un personnage dans une pièce de théâtre. Cependant, il existe une différence fondamentale entre la simulation des larmes d'un être humain et celle d'un robot. Un être humain est littéralement incarné dans un corps trace, incarné, chair, inscrit dans une histoire du vivant, dans un temps et un espace donné, tandis qu'un robot a un corps trace composé d'artefacts évoluant avec les techniques de construction de machines binaires basées sur des règles. La photo de Sophia, humanoïde bien connue. Le robot humanoïde vise à répliquer les concepts développés dans le paradigme de l'homme trace qui, comme nous l'avons vu précédemment, s'appuie sur une épistémologie constructiviste basée sur les interactions corps-milieu. Sur cette base, nous comprenons que ce type de robot est capable de découvrir son environnement à partir d'un corps trace activé par les interactions corps-milieu. Mais, comme c'est le cas avec les humains, le robot ne peut pas connaître la réalité en soi. Le robot n'est pas un être humain. Il n'en sera jamais un. même si le corps du robot humanoïde pourrait éventuellement devenir aussi complexe que celui de l'humain, il n'aura jamais la même histoire. L'intelligence artificielle a été conçue initialement par les humains et non l'inverse. Si nous adoptons la définition de l'éthique de Spinoza, je cite, qui vit sous la direction de la raison, désire aussi pour les autres le bien qu'il s'appête. Il faut alors se demander ce que signifie prendre en commun les autres et le bien commun dans le contexte international de l'intelligence artificielle et du numérique, car le bien commun n'y est pas conçu de la même manière selon les points de la planète. Soulignons l'impossible séparation entre anthropogénèse et technogénèse. La figure de l'homme trace a été illustrée tout au long de l'histoire de l'humanité. Si l'on considère Homo erectus, l'espèce a laissé des traces dans la façon dont elle occupait les territoires. Homo erectus adaptait les hommes pour dormir, pour les repas, etc. et avait un meilleur contrôle pour travailler la pierre que ses prédécesseurs Homo habilis et Homo ergaster. Lorsque les humains ont produit des outils radicalement différents, les paléontologues les ont appelés Homo sapiens. La découverte des corps permet d'observer que le corps changeait à chaque période. Le corps est devenu plus grand et avait une position plus droite. Les proportions de l'encéphale ont changé à mesure que les outils devenaient plus complexes. Une observation qui tend à renforcer la relation systémique existant entre la production de traces externes, ici la technologie, et la production de traces internes, ici l'activation toujours croissante des connexions neuronales. Prenons la photo du cerveau. Le paradigme a été illustré, de l'homme trace a été illustré à travers l'histoire, à travers l'évolution du cerveau, qui est en interaction avec le contexte, comme nous venons de l'indiquer. Venons-en aux interactions humains-robots. Comme le montre la figure image de Gerd Hartmann, les interactions robots-humains ont un impact sur l'évolution de l'un et de l'autre. L'homme trace évolue avec le milieu avec lequel il interagit. Le robot également. Donc l'un et l'autre vont évoluer. Dans cette image, la figure présente l'intégration des interactions homme-robot sur le corps trace d'un homme trace. En conclusion, les outils les plus récents exploitent la calculabilité des systèmes informatiques. Comme ceux qui les ont précédés, ces outils, car il s'agit toujours d'outils, permettent de faire évoluer les pratiques humaines, les représentations du monde, les schémas cognitifs et l'ensemble de ce que nous appelons le corps trace. Comprendre les influences des outils dans l'évolution de l'ichnos anthropos, homme trace, est essentiel. Cette évolution implique une approche réflexive, d'abord et avant tout, à propos de la manière dont le comportement contemporain produit au quotidien des conséquences traces qui construisent la société demain, et ensuite à propos de la place que l'éthique occupe dans les choix faits. Aujourd'hui, l'histoire de l'ichnos anthropos, l'homme trace, suit son cours au fil des jours. Il est en constante évolution. Ce qui relie une personne d'aujourd'hui au passé de l'humanité reste présent dans l'homme trace de demain. Le corps trace de l'homme trace continuera d'évoluer avec le milieu dans lequel vivront les êtres humains de demain. La conscience critique de notre condition en tant qu'ichnos anthropos peut affecter notre perception des conséquences de notre relation avec l'environnement. D'où l'importance de cette prise de conscience. Les humains sont devenus plus sensibles à la valeur de concevoir le rôle de la trace dans le développement durable, non seulement pour l'humanité, mais aussi pour leur planète Terre, dans le cosmos, d'où l'intérêt d'enseigner le paradigme de l'homme trace dans les écoles, et cela dès le plus jeune âge, en le simplifiant, bien entendu. Merci pour votre attention.
Merci beaucoup, Béatrice, pour cette présentation complexe, comme est la pensée et la science. Mia?
Yes, thank you very much, Professor Beatrice, for the presentation. I believe this is something that is very much related to anthropology, and of course there is the link of anthropology and communication as well in regards to the topic that you have. I was interested in your comment in regards to AI was designed by humans, not the other way around. So it should not be the one that controls us, but should be the one that that we should be able to control. So I would like to take this opportunity to have a sort of like a feedback or discuss it from Professor Schulhoff in the two topics presented by Dr. Lucas, as well as what has been presented by Professor Beatrice. Professor Schulhoff, the time is yours.
Thank you very much. Ladies and gentlemen, first of all, I would like to thank Dr. Adisa Bahayon for inviting me as discussant at this conference. And I would like to thank for their support, Mr. Stéphane Dover, Consular for Cooperation of the French Embassy in Indonesia, and our colleagues from Indonesia, from Jakarta. And it's therefore a good pleasure for me to take part in this conference, which highlights the exceptional work of my colleague and friend, Professor Beatrice Galinon-Malenek, but also Dr. Lucas. The work of Beatrice Galinon-Malenek is part of the e-laboratory on human trace unit win UNESCO complex systems digital campus track, which she was the leader for many, many years. I myself coordinated the CoreMT cognitive remediation human trace DC track, and mainly my role concerns artificial intelligence and modeling, traces, data, and knowledge in the field of health. We are interested in the ethical implication of AI in medicine, and also in other areas such as AI in marketing and decision support system, and more recently chatbots as autonomous AI and the ethical consequences of the relationship with the end user. Maybe you will wonder whether what is the relationship is between medicine and marketing. Both belong to human sciences, where we are talking about human emotions and his psyche and his life in society, and they both rely on systemic and constructivism approach, as Beatrice Galinon-Malenek said. As the Spanish poet Antonio Machado, traveler, there is no path. The path is made by walking. In terms of cognitive psychology, we study how cognitive dissonance, defined by Leon Festinger, and placebo are used in sales. How knowledge models, AI heuristics, and behaviors can be used to model cognitive dissonance and placebo effects. which is also widely studied in the medical field, in particular in therapeutics and to relieve addictions. Professor Beatrice Galino-Malenek is best known for his work on TWIST, and in particular the concept of human TWIST man. This paradigm applies to many domains, including the TWIST body, where the TWIST is observed by the doctor in the clinic are essential to medical semiology and the diagnosis of disease. In particular, it describes the process in which these weak signals that are TWISTs become clinically exploited as TWIST signs. Professor Bernakitus traces the relevance of the clinical approach in marketing, but also to diagnose and cure the dysfunction of companies, as he points out in his thesis of habilitation to supervise researchers in management. Professor Alain Mill is a French computer scientist, friend of our team, and in his article from TWIST to knowledge in the web age, he clearly underlines the importance of digital TWISTs, whose consideration becomes the basis of the hierarchy of information as we define in our work, TWISTs, data, knowledge, and meta-knowledge. Data scientists often forget to consider these sub-symbolic elements that are TWISTs, which are essential to the understanding of our world, as Beatrice stressed in her presentation. Digital TWISTs have therefore become indispensable in the tools of customer relationship management to find prospects and define the different profiles of customers and web users, but also to determine which products are going to be successful and which ones are going to decrease in the market. Like Beatrice Galino-Malenek, I pointed out the abuse of the use of these resources, which pose ethical problems related to the use of personal data of individuals in the intrusion into their privacy. This is particularly true in the health field, where many products are sometimes offered by neglecting the relationship between caregivers and patients and by promoting self-medication, which can be dangerous. These ethical problems have been studied particularly in our team, in particular in the context of the PhD work of Dr. Relwende Aristidiamergo, who has just defended a thesis on this subject, and the thesis was supervised by Beatrice and myself. We're also looking forward to attending INCOMAC conference in October. I don't want to take too long, so I'm going to open it up to discussion around these exciting topics. So I would like to ask to Beatrice Galino-Malenek a first question. Would you mind to explain the importance of the body TWIST and how the observer, for example, the doctor, shifts from the TWIST to the sign, and how this is useful in the clinical approach relatively to the history of each individual? We have recalled that the clinical approach is common to medicine and marketing domains, and how these sign traces are simplified to fit the healthcare networks and with the laws of precision and accuracy, and perhaps some errors or biases, as she points in her discussion. Beatrice?
Pourrais-tu reformuler la question en français, s'il te plaît?
Question en français. Beatrice, quelle est l'importance de l'homme trace et du corps trace pour l'observateur, donc notamment le médecin, et comment il passe de la trace au signe trace, Et comment, comment effectivement cet aspect lié donc à l'histoire de chacun, individu, et notamment de, dans l'approche clinique qui est commune à la médecine et au domaine marketing. Comment le SYNTRAS est simplifié pour tenir compte, enfin pour entrer dans les réseaux de santé. Voilà. Et avec peut-être une perte de précision et de pertinence, et éventuellement peut-être des erreurs ou des biais.
Oui, merci pour ces questions. Alors, la réponse sera risque d'être un peu longue compte tenu de l'ampleur de la question. Alors, comment passe-t-on de la trace au signe? Alors, dans le paradigme de l'homme-trace, on part du principe que la trace, en tant que conséquence, conçue comme la conséquence d'un événement, existe sans qu'elle soit forcément perçue par l'humain.
Donc, par exemple... Juste un moment, Béatrice. Juste un moment, voilà. So, when we think about trace as a consequence of an event or of a process, we don't say that the trace is visible. It can be also invisible. Oui.
Donc, dans le corps, par exemple, il existe de nombreuses traces. Le corps étant constitué que de traces, essentiellement.
The human body is produced from traces and has a lot of traces.
Yeah.
Voilà. Et donc, ces traces existent alors même que la personne qui est, si je peux dire, titulaire de ce corps, n'en a pas conscience. C'est même le principe de Freud, de l'émergence de la signification des traces par la psychanalyse, par exemple.
And the person is not aware of all the traces that composed his body. This is the signification of trace in the psychanalyse of Freud, for example.
Donc, les traces, le corps trace est non seulement inconnu par la personne elle-même, mais dans sa complexité, elle n'est pas connue par les tiers qui le regardent, qui l'observent.
So the trace is not recognized by the person itself and by the others. Let's say a lot of traces are not recognized and visible by the others.
Quand une personne va voir un médecin, elle demande un diagnostic. Le médecin est lui-même un homme trace dans un corps trace.
So when the person go to see a doctor, the person goes with its traces. And the doctor himself or herself is also a product of traces.
Donc, la rencontre entre le médecin et le patient est une rencontre entre deux corps traces.
So, yeah, the meeting between the doctor and the patient is a kind of meeting between two human traces or homme trace.
Le médecin, quand il est en contact avec le patient, va percevoir, parmi toutes les traces que comprend le corps trace, il va effectuer un tri, il va effectuer un jugement qui est un tri sur les traces du corps trace, et à partir de ce moment-là, cela signifie que pour lui, les traces retenues sont des signes traces, des symptômes.
So during the diagnosis, the medic or the doctor will select some of the traces of the patient. These traces became or become sign traces because he observed them, he detected them, and he selected them.
Deux médecins ne sont pas, n'ont pas deux corps traces identiques. Donc, on peut, en étant malade, aller voir un premier médecin qui ne trouve rien, puis aller voir un second médecin qui, lui, va activer des signes traces grâce à son corps trace. Donc, le patient, il a son corps trace qui ne change pas, mais selon le médecin qui est donc dans des corps traces différents, eh bien, les signes traces qui vont apparaître sont différents. Les tris faits par les médecins sont différents.
Different, yeah. So the selection is different because each medic has a different body trace or corps trace, and he will select or he will detect some different signs. So patient can, for example, do consultancy with the two medics, and each medic will give him or will select some sign traces different from the other.
Donc on voit ici un premier tri parmi des traces devenant signe trace, une première sélection.
So first selection is the one of some of sign traces of the body. So the example of the medic.
Donc, ces deux médecins, s'ils doivent reporter sur l'ordinateur les résultats de la consultation, vont inscrire, ces deux médecins vont inscrire des informations différentes sur le même patient.
So if the two medics will write their observation about the same patient, each one will write the sign traces that he observed. So we will have two different observations.
Or, le médecin qui a une obligation de transférer le résultat de la consultation au système de santé est contraint par le format informatique.
So yeah, the medic that has the obligation to transfer his observation to the health system will be confronted to a big challenge, is the one of the IT or the IT system that he will use.
Donc, l'information concernant ce patient qui est mise dans le système de santé est déjà une réduction très importante de l'information concernant le patient. Il y a donc des biais cognitifs.
Yeah, so the information that will be included inside the IT system will not be the same one that the medic observed, because he is obliged to follow some rules and other conditions.
Il faut savoir que le médecin ne connaît rien en informatique et il est dépendant du logiciel que le spécialiste en informatique médicale a placé dans son ordinateur.
Yeah, so medic will be dependent from the IT system.
Or, les logiciels médicaux ne sont pas tous les mêmes.
The IT softwares are not all the same.
Donc, l'information qui a été la même information mise dans deux logiciels différents fait encore l'objet de tri et de sélection au niveau de la donnée.
Yeah, so the information that was included inside two IT systems different will not be the same, and it will create also a kind of difference concerning the data.
Donc cette réduction de complexité se retrouve dans tous les points du système de santé.
And this kind of reduction of the information will exist in all the health system.
Parce que ce soit que les informations proviennent de la consultation médicale, de l'hôpital ou des systèmes administratifs de santé, on a toujours des hommes traces qui sont devant des ordinateurs et qui simplifient les données pour qu'elles rentrent dans des logiciels qui les contraignent.
Yeah, so information coming from different health sources and health systems will be simplified so it can fit inside the IT context ruled or managed by human beings.
Oui, donc partout on a des hommes traces. Et ce sont ces données, ces informations qui sont qui arrivent à un carrefour traité par l'intelligence artificielle.
And this data will arrive in other phases to be treated by artificial intelligence.
Donc l'intelligence artificielle traite des données biaisées.
Yes, so artificial intelligence will work with selected data.
Selecté et donc biaisé sur un plan cognitif.
Maybe wrong.
Et donc.
Comment? Biaisé donc.
Biaisé, biaisé, c'est-à-dire faussé.
Biaisé.
Faussé. Faussé.
Not necessarily faussé. Yeah, but I mean, yeah. Not the same.
Par rapport
not from the origin.
Par rapport à la complexité initiale.
Yeah.
Et c'est ce résultat-là qu'on va relancer dans le système de santé, de telle sorte que le médecin, revenons-en au médecin dans sa consultation, eh bien, pour l'aide à la décision médicale, il consulte ce résultat.
Yeah, so the medic finally will be consulting these final results, which are simplified, which don't take in consideration the complexity, and they will use it to give his orientation.
Donc, d'où la nécessité de, à tous les points que nous avons cités, de porter une attention particulière avec une rigueur éthique sur l'information que l'on met dans le circuit.
And this is why we should respect the ethic questions about the information that we use inside this system, for example, taking in consideration its complexity.
Je ne sais pas si j'ai répondu à la question. En tous les cas, cela veut dire que c'est les humains, les hommes traces, qui sont partout dans le système derrière la machine et que tous les biais cognitifs, la mauvaise information qui est par rapport à la complexité qui circule, eh bien, peut être limité si chaque humain, si chaque homme trace interroge son propre comportement au lieu de dire c'est pas moi, c'est l'ordinateur, c'est pas moi, c'est la machine, c'est pas moi, c'est comme on l'entend partout. Non.
This is why it's important, yeah, that every individual who is human trace, AmTrace, no, question his behavior when he used the information, so the information will not be a bad one and will not be modified and understood.
Je ne sais pas si j'ai répondu à la question.
Yeah. Joël, thank you very much, Beatrice.
Okay, thank you. Apologies, I was my electricity, so I could be able to interact the first session. So thank you very much, Professor Vicious, for the explanation. And then Professor Holok has a few questions. I think we should just go directly to the chat. Is that okay, Hadi? There are some questions.
Yes.
Maybe we can go directly to the question from Professor Holok, Professor Joe Holok, to Dr. Lucas.
Yeah, please. So I can, Dr. Lucas, I would like to ask you, thank you for your good presentation first. Sorry. And what about the shift from the mimetic artificial intelligence, and that is a decision support system, expert systems, towards the autonomous artificial intelligence, that is robots, and what are the consequences of the shift of autonomous towards autonomous systems that concern the place of the users, the end users, and the role of them, and the interaction with these autonomous systems, for example, self-driving cars, as you you presented in your during your presentation. Who is responsible for, who can be responsible for damage to people, to pedestrians, for example?
Yes, thank you, Prof. Joel Klopp. For the question, so it was quite a philosophical question. So this shift is namely artificial intelligence was developed by engineers who work mostly with objects, non-living thing, and we have freedom to create many things. And now, when it start leaving the lab and entering the society, then there is problem with the relationship with the human. So your question about ethics is very valid, and it's very important question nowadays, because not only autonomous car, but even now many AI applications have been used in our mobile application. Thousands, millions of people have been using this AI based application. So the question about AI ethics has been discussed by many societies, including our Indonesian society. But let me refer to some of the prominent corporation, for instance, IBM or Google. They have the ethical principles. For instance, from the IBM, it is mentioned three principles. That the first one, the purpose of AI is to augment human intelligence. So to help, to enhance the human intelligence. And then the second one, data and insight belong to their creator. And the third one, technology must be transparent and explainable. So this is, for example, the principles that have been between, it is a fighting, in fact. AI really needs data. We can only create something, an algorithm can only learn when there is available data, and especially a lot of data. While on the other hand, as you are living in Europe, which is very protecting the data privacy, right? Data itself need to be protected such that it will not harm individuals. So there should be a discussion, a compromise between them on which and how far data can be accumulated and can be processed by AI. That's the principles. Okay, for the Google, they have more points. Perhaps I can read it here quickly. There are 7 points. Principles in Google AI. The first one is socially beneficial, so it should be useful to the society. Second, avoid creating and reinforcing unfair bias. This is also important because it has been found that AI can be biased due to the available data or to the given data to the training set. And then be built and tested for safety. This will also relate to your question about autonomous car. And then fourth is be accountable to people. So this AI development and usage must also be able to be accountable. Who will be responsible for this usage? And then the fifth one is incorporate privacy design principle. Sixth one is uphold high standards in scientific excellence. And seven, be made available for users that accord with these principles. So it means the discussion about the accountability also very important in AI. Just take the example of the self-driving car. Suppose some engineers has created this autonomous car by a company, and that company has sold that car to someone. In this case, maybe Dr. Nia has the car, and then someone, maybe Dr. Hadi, used the car, for instance. And on the way, there is an accident, and who will be responsible for that? Will that car be, for instance, be caught and must stay in the police office for some days? And that will not change the car, right? Because it's just a non-living item. But we can go deeper into who is responsible. In fact, based on the situation, if the situation is on the way while driving, for instance, Dr. Hadi is with the car and he has the control on the car. In fact, he can press the brake to stop if there is the accident. So he is the closest to the control of the system, right? Of course, although it is self-autonomous, but there is still a key in this AI technology called human in the loop. So we propose that in the ethical AI, that human will still be in the process of decision support, taking the decision. So although the system can propose, can automate, but in any situation, human can override and take control of that machine. So that's the in the loop. There's also human on the loop. So on top of the system, we are the creator of this AI. So we still have the full control of the machine. Whatever we would like to change to the system, the algorithm, the some parameters, like what you mentioned about while it is on the way, people still have control. Because it was some people afraid that if AI towards the singularity becomes independent, becomes uncontrolled by people, then that machine will protect itself to be modified by human. So therefore, from the beginning, during the design, human must put control into that system, that human will always have final decision, will have the control of what the machine can do. That's the accountability. And maybe the one additional point to be mentioned is explainability. So it is also very challenging for us because not everything in AI algorithm can be explained during the deduction process. So the requirement for this accountability, like human, when we meet some doctor, for instance, in health, normally we have some discussion with the doctor. When the doctor said about some disease, some medication, he or she will explain about the situation. And this is also will be the case for AI. So therefore, now the challenge for AI is AI must be able to explain the reasoning. It is called explainable AI. So this is one of the domain in AI where not only giving a good response, less error, but that system must be able to explain rationally to the people how it comes to that decision. Perhaps that's my question for Professor Chul Kolok. Thank you.
Very interesting. I want just to add a very short question, because I understood that you're talking about machines that acting that are acting or executing some programs. But what about, for example, prediction algorithms? What about information coming from different kind of softwares that are giving us some orientation or information about the weather, about, for example, the pandemic, etc. These are not programs that are waiting for some execution. They are orienting us or giving us some information that I think also about search engines, for example, that will present us some reality about different issues. So these kind of results will not be really examined or questioned by the users.
Yes, the use of mathematics in or algorithms in processing statistics can several ways. The first one, normally statistical description to describe the numbers, the situation, and then there is predictive and further prescriptive, right? And what you mentioned is about predictive. So for instance, predicting the weather, predicting the situation. So all of that, I think that's also relevant what Professor Beatrice mentioned. This machine has very limitation. It doesn't have the senses like us. We have five senses. We can see, we can hear, we can feel. Well, machine can only read numbers. And whatever numbers given, it will regard it as the truth by the machine. So whatever will be predicted based on this given data, that will be for the machine itself, it's something like deterministic. It is quite convinced for the machine saying this. While us as human, while we are receiving, while we are reading this result from the machine, we can still reason. Is it totally belief, or can I have some doubt of it? For instance, prediction on weather, prediction on stock forecasting. Sometimes there are some external factors, right? Which is not parameters given to the computer. So the computer may fail to predict something because in some situation, those parameters didn't enter to the computer to be processed, right? Like the weather, sometimes there is a like tsunami. No machine learning able to predict tsunami case, whatever the situation so far with the historical data in Japan and wherever, it is still very hard because there are some unpredicted or unobserved. It is very hard to get that parameter to be able to be processed by computer. If the parameters is able to be recorded or enter to the computer, perhaps the prediction of the computer will be better. That's Dr. Adi.
Thank you very much, Dr. Lucas, for your explanation. And I think the intricacy of humans and machine is something that can be a discussion forever, right? Because again, robots are robots and it's made by human. And if it does overpower a human, it's kind of a bit scary as well. There, it looks like that our discussion has also intrigued other questions coming in. So I'll just go thoroughly from the top that has come in. There are a few questions. I will start from Andrew Witt. I'm sure you can read it, Palukas, so I don't need to save time. If you can answer from for Andrew. Because it seems this is for you, but maybe Hadi, would you like to also provide a translation if Professor Beatrice would like to also chime in?
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Andrew Witarsa, for the question. So the question is about how AI will affect the current economy, especially for workers and finding full-time job. We know that these changes is not only during this AI era. It has already been maybe more than 100 years ago when first industrial revolution came into our society. basically the need is to always improve. People will try to get a better situation in business. They try to get a more efficient resource and better and faster production and so on, right? So in this, and moreover with this AI, so most of the repetitive tasks will for sure will be replaced by AI. So it's very hard, or it is impossible for people to resist this, because all business will always calculate on the cost and problems. In comparison with robots and machine, people working in the factory, sometimes they got tired, they got bored, they have some strike. Yeah. Sometimes they have some complaints. Well, if they buy machine, the machine will work 24/7 without any complaints, with the stable performance and much less maintenance cost. So okay, my sentence perhaps mechanistic, not thinking about human, but what I would like to emphasize is, okay, let's be human. So human not only able to do repetitive tasks, let's move, let's upskill, let's learn more or reskill, let's change our capabilities to others. Like when some people said about the washing machine will replace the workers who do manual laundry. Why don't take it positively? Since there are washing machine, then these people can become the laundry directors, laundry owners, become the business man or business woman. So it means with this technology, people can shift to a better, to less tedious or physical efforts, to more thinking, more empathic traits of human. So I think that's the main point for to help humanity, and also provide solution for the problem, less of work opportunity. So yes, as mentioned in many analysis also, this advance of technology and AI perhaps will, as I said before, will replace many workforces, those work by human, by replaced with machine. But this new development will also create new new opportunities. Like internet, maybe before 90s there was no internet, we still live without internet, but now since there's internet, there are some jobs available due to the internet, internet provider, internet programming, internet maintenance, even website search engine optimization, user interface or user experience designer, and others. So please be optimistic. There will be more new job will be available replacing those which is taken by the machine.
New fields, maybe. Yeah. Yes. Yes. Thank you. I want to ask Beatrice about if she has any comment about this. Qu'est-ce que vous pensez de l'influence de l'intelligence artificielle sur le domaine du travail, surtout dans le futur? Comment, je veux dire, les deux côtés, hein, positifs peut-être et négatifs, ou avantages et désavantages?
Oui, alors déjà, tout dépend la définition que l'on donne du travail dans les organisations. Dans les organisations, très souvent, évidemment, l'objectif, c'est la productivité, l'efficience, le résultat. En vue d'atteindre les meilleurs profits ou les meilleurs bénéfices, au moins dans nos économies monétaires. Oui, tu veux parler? Oui,
voilà. So it depends on the definition that we give to work. In general, in organization. an organization, we seek the productivity, the efficiency, and the best results of the activity.
Excuse-moi. Donc, en fait, dans ma conception de la communication des organisations, évidemment, je parle en milieu et place de sciences de l'information et la communication et l'anthropologie. Les entreprises et l'organisation, ce sont des interactions d'humains. L'organisation, elle n'est pas que fonctionnelle. Elle n'est pas qu'un système d'information en vue de la productivité et la performance. Elle est aussi le résultat de l'interaction entre des humains.
So from information and communication sciences and anthropology point of view, organization is not just a system of information, it's also a place where there are human interactions.
Donc, dans ce domaine, c'est ce que les Canadiens appellent la communication organisante. C'est la communication qui produit l'organisation.
So a Canadian call the organisation. C'était quoi en français?
Les Canadiens appellent cela la communication organisante, c'est-à-dire la communication qui construit l'organisation.
So the communication that build organization.
D'accord. Donc c'est les relations humaines sont ne peuvent pas être mises de côté par des entreprises, même si leur objectif essentiel, c'est le fonctionnement des outils, la communication de l'information ou les supports de l'information. Ce n'est pas parce qu'on informatise toute une entreprise l'on va nécessairement améliorer la communication au sens de relations humaines.
Yeah, so we cannot ignore the human communication, which is very important inside the organization, even if organization will upgrade or will use IT systems and IT communication. But it's very important to consider the human relationships inside the enterprise.
Comme on le disait à l'instant, l'humain, ce n'est pas que de la rationalité, c'est de l'émotion, de l'affect, c'est un sentiment d'avoir un bien-être ou un mal-être avec les partenaires avec lesquels ils travaillent.
So a human being is not just rationality, is also emotions and affects. He can have a good mood and bad mood, and his relationships with the others are very important.
Donc, l'expérience que nous venons de vivre de la crise sanitaire a été très intéressante à ce sujet.
The health crisis that we witnessed recently is a very good example of what are we talking about.
Chaque personne de l'entreprise travaillait en contact avec le télétravail, via le télétravail. La communication à distance.
So people have been working at home, at distance.
On aurait pu penser, a priori, que le salarié aurait été content d'être chez lui, dans son espace personnel, avec un environnement qu'il connaît bien.
Yeah, so we thought that maybe individuals will be very happy to work from home because they have their own space that they know very well.
Car il est vrai que le travail à distance ne modifie pas l'information que l'on transmet d'un service à un autre.
Yeah, because working from home will not change the information that we will use or we will communicate between systems.
Par contre, ça change la relation entre les humains.
Therefore, it changed a lot the relationship between humans.
C'est pourquoi la fin du confinement, du moins dans notre pays, a réjoui les salariés, la majorité des salariés, finalement très contents de quitter leur bulle familiale pour se retrouver dans un espace de travail où les relations étaient vraiment de corps-trace à corps-trace.
Yeah, this is why the confinement and the end of the confinement in France, for example, was a moment of happiness for a lot of employees who were very glad to come back to their professional environments to meet the others. This is the interaction between body trace or corps trace or corps, body traces. So yeah, we're talking about several people meeting again.
Alors, déjà que les logiciels, que l'ensemble du processus technique valorise avant tout la rationalité, la logique.
It's true that the system or the IT system in general gives priority to rationality.
Si l'on ajoute en plus la communication à distance, on appauvrit la matière humaine, ce que peut produire la relation humaine dans la société.
Yeah, so if we add to this rationality, the working from home or the social distance between persons, so we will decrease the richness of a human relationship.
Donc, évidemment, si l'on favorise l'information au détriment de la communication conçue comme la relation, on arrive, comment dire, les robots qui eux-mêmes fonctionnent sans la dimension de l'affect et de l'émotion, peuvent être parfaitement intégrés avec les humains dans les relations, mais on a une déperdition de ce qu'est l'intérêt même de l'humain.
So if we give priority to information and not to communication, and especially human communication, so it is as if we are calling robots to take our places and to work at the place of the human being. And this is a big question about what does we want from a human being.
Donc la communication, dans ma définition, il faut être clair, parce que c'est polysémique, la communication, c'est la relation. Relation entre deux corps traces.
So communication, according to Beatrice Galinon-Mélenec, is the relationship between two body traces, corps traces.
Voilà. Et ceci, c'est une déclinaison de ce qui avait déjà été dit au siècle dernier dans le cadre de ce que l'on nomme l'école de Palo Alto.
Yeah, and this definition comes from Palo Alto School in the United States of America in the 20th century and their works on communication.
Je ne sais pas si j'ai répondu à la question. OK, merci.
I think we are a bit running out of time at the moment, and I see a lot of great questions. And maybe we can sort of like provide, put it all into one big question, which is basically coming back to the existence of AI. I mean, how much will it actually affect our daily life? And most importantly is, you know, do we really want them to take over or not? And, you know, looking at these questions is also about regulation And is it actually needed? Which Professor Holok has already mentioned that it is something that is important to look at. And a great question is like, is it something that the United Nations need to actually intervene as well? So maybe I'll give this last opportunity here for Dr. Lucas to provide one paragraph of what your thoughts are about all the implications of AI. And then we can move on to Professor Beatrice to also provide one sort of like a closing statement. And also Professor Holok, who is the discussant, he has provided some answers in the chat. So hopefully, Hadi, if you can save the whole chat later on, so that maybe we can address one by one later on the questions that they have. So please go ahead, Dr. Lucas.
Yes, thank you. There are some very interesting questions, in fact. Okay, unfortunately, time is limited. So the main question is about the progressing of AI. AI so far will always improving better and better because everyone is expecting that. And it's good for business as well. It's good for entertainment. It's good for people because people would like to have easy life. So we will we will see those technology entering our life. For sure, AI, as Prof. Holok also mentioned, have some limitation. Prof. Edris also mentioned the basic idea of AI, where it is only thing. It has some limitation on nobody. It has nobody, so and no historical. It's only relies on data given. So if we would like to survive on this AI era, then we should keep our human traits. Namely, we should have our honesty. We should have our creativity. We should have our charm, because robot has no charm. So one of the example of the question, for instance, will AI replace doctor, for instance? For me, I will say no. For instance, just imagine nowadays, every one of us has ever come to a doctor. When you feel some illness and then you just come to the doctor, while you're waiting outside in the waiting room, your illness perhaps has decreased, maybe 10%. When you are called, you enter the room of the doctor, maybe reduced to 50%. When the doctor start to diagnose you and give you some suggestion, perhaps it's already relieved to 30%. And the last one, maybe after you get medication, you will feel confident, you will get better. Now just compare that with mobile apps. Now there are some AI application in the mobile phone where you have online consultation, but with mobile phone. You can type anything. You can say, I feel fever, I have headache, and so on. Just imagine, after you close that application, do you feel better? Because we are emotional human. We need interaction. We cannot just serve by machine. We still want to have human touch. That also happens not only in medical, but also in shops, for instance. Just imagine there are many, for instance, shopping stores, but in comparison to traditional stores, which has, it was like 20 years ago, where we can come and we can say hi to the seller, how are you? And then how's the weather and so on, but it gives our warm situation. We can feel that we are human. Rather than you can just come to the shop, pick some things, pay and go out, right? Okay, you get what you need, but you don't feel as human. You feel satisfied with that, right? So in some works, in some places, AI will more and more influencing. Of course, the topic also with the data. And some also refer to the regulation, because in Indonesia, we are still lag behind. Europe has already GDPR, while in Indonesia, we are still discussing about that law, right, which is still in our parliament. Hopefully, by this year, we will have the law, so Undang-Undang Perlindungan Data Pribadi. So that's the data private data.
Yes. Oh, did Pak Lukas?
Yes.
Okay, thank you, Pavlukas. Is that okay, is that yeah? Because you froze at the end of the sentence. So I guess we provide this time, Hadi, to Dr. Maybe Beatrice to provide her summary of this discussion.
Oui, Béatrice, une conclusion de votre part.
Alors, oui, vous m'entendez?
Oui.
Alors, d'abord, je voudrais vous remercier car je trouve ces échanges extrêmement intéressants. J'ai été ravie d'entendre Dr. Lucas s'exprimer dans les termes dans lesquels il s'est exprimé. D'abord, sa communication initiale était extrêmement intéressante et très bien illustrée. Et merci et bravo. Donc, évidemment...
Un moment. Professor Galinon Melinek is thanking everyone. She's very glad to participate to this webinar. And she was very interested by the presentation of Professor Lucas. It was a very, very excellently explained. And thanks for the organizers of the webinar. Oui, Béatrice.
Oui, et j'ai été sensible que, alors que son approche est celle de l'informaticien, il sache rappeler le rôle de l'émotion, le rôle de l'humain, donc permettant ainsi de faire une passerelle avec ma propre intervention.
She was impressed also by your proper approach, Dr. Lucas, as an IT expert. But in the same time, taking in consideration emotion and the human being's affects. And this is important because you created or you built a kind of bridge between your presentation and and what Beatrice Galinon-Melinek presented in her work.
Donc, merci beaucoup. Dans cette intervention, je n'ai pas pu forcément... présenté peut-être suffisamment concrètement avec des exemples le paradigme de l'homme trace, mais peut-être l'avez-vous vu rapidement lors de la dernière diapositive, il existe des livres sur l'homme trace qui contiennent de nombreux exemples d'applications qui pourront intéresser les uns et les autres selon leur discipline ou leur profession.
Yeah, so maybe she didn't get the time to explain in details with a lot of examples the human trace AmTrace paradigm, but she's mentioning at the end of her presentation there's a slide presenting different kind of books that have been published directed by Beatrice Galinon-Melinek and other colleagues about human trace, AmTrace, that can interest our audience depending on their disciplines and their backgrounds.
Merci.
So thank you very much.
Yes, merci, Professor Beatrice. Professor Holland, you have made some comments in the chat, so hopefully some people have actually read it. I think I agree with you that empathy is not something that artificial intelligence has. As we have seen a lot of movies as well, that AI doesn't have empathy, basically just following the rules or maybe changing the rules by themselves. So that's kind of scary. Maybe perhaps round this all up, Professor Holok, this discussion, and to see what is the future for AI in communication. Thank you.
I would like to say that artificial intelligence did a lot of advances, very interesting, and AI is very useful in many, many domains, especially in medicine, and especially, for example, to diagnose some cancer, especially skin cancer, for example, or and so on. And for example, for image recognition, there are a lot of advances done by deep learning approaches, for example. And but I think that the physician is always necessary and I agree with Dr. Lucas when he said human in the loop is very important, because I think that at the last the physician should be responsible of the treatment and the decision made concerning the patient. And and it's important to say that explainability of algorithm is, I think it's very important, but is in fact very difficult to do, because the complexity of these algorithms are not easy to explain to people who have not especially knowledge about computer science, for example. And I think it's difficult for us, for example, to understand what these algorithms can do with their data. And I think, in fact, this approach of explainability of algorithm, in fact, is difficult to obtain. And what I can say about some questions, if AI must respect the role and the place of the users, I think, for example, autonomous AI systems change the role and the place of the different users. And I think that we must beware about the place of the users, who have to accept the use of the robots, for example, and they have a consent that should be obtained of the users as a user of the system. And the user must give the consent, for example, for the data concerning himself should be used or not. Okay, I think...
Perfect, yes. Thank you very much, Professor Pollock. I think you provided a great... combining all of the, I would say, the expertise of everyone here, you know, from Lucas from the engineering side, and you being part also as a doctor from the human side and the engineering side of it, as well as going back into the roots of our history in anthropology. So thank you very much, everyone. It was a very great discussion that we have here, and thank you for the wonderful questions from lecturers and students. I believe you have made the term critical thinking something that's very important in our daily life. All right, so I would like to provide this opportunity. We'll try to be able to provide the answers for some of them later on the text. Perhaps Professor Dr. Lucas would have the opportunity to do that. But time is constrained for us, and we have to close. And I would like to provide this opportunity to Dr. Doreen and Dr. Echo. Please feel free who will go first to close our today's session, and welcoming everyone to attend the ICOMEX 6 in October. The floor is yours.
Okay, I think I will go first, Mbak Nia. Thank you very much for this opportunity. Well, as Hadi mentioned in the introduction, this webinar series is brought to the sixth ECOMAC and FADO collaborations between Atmajaya Catholic University as well as Le Havre University. Here, I like to take the opportunity to invite all of the participants to come and join the ECOMAC, especially for its plenary session that will be on Atmajaya official YouTube as well. By joining the webinar, we will broaden our knowledge and on communication ethics, which is the one that we discussed in the discussion. So ethics is really important, and here we can also understand that AI is has its advantage and disadvantage. But the thing is that we need to encourage ourselves to to collaborate, because there is nothing impossible, and it just needs courage to empower the networking regarding collaborations to be wise. Lots of perspectives that can be better than ours. Here we admit that collaboration is the key, and a multidiscipline view and approach is a way to have a better understanding and contribute to problem solving, especially in our daily life. So as a closing, I want to thank to Prof. Kolok, Dr. Hadi Sabahayon, and Dr. Mia Sarinasiti, who put their thought, time, and energy into preparing this prestigious webinar, and to Professor Beatrice and Dr. Lucas, who shared their wonderful talk, as well as Professor Fabian Lennart, Professor Michael Hosenhorn, Mr. Stefan Dover, perhaps, I hope I'm not make a mistake in pronunciation, and also Dr. Johannes Eko Adi Prasetyanto, Dr. Eko Widodo, and then Ibu Rusdiana Sijabat, as well as Dr. Rory Hutagalung, who assist us in a translation. So I hope everybody enjoy this webinar, and we can have further discussion later on. And I really hope that this collaboration will be broader and farther and long lasting. Perhaps someday we can visit each other. Thank you.
As soon as possible.
Thank you, Dr. Doreen. Dr. Eko, kindly provide your remarks.
Okay, thank you, Bunia. First, thank you for Professor Beatrice, Professor Joel Kolok, Adi, my friend, Adi Sabahayon, Lucas, Mbak Nia, Mbak Doreen, Bu Rusdiana, and all of the participants of the webinar is a kind of our collaboration. And as we know that the global problem is in the future is big, become more complex and more bigger. So to handle that we need our participation together to solve the problem, the problem, and also the global problem. My president, the president, Mr. Jokowi, yesterday said in the United Nations Assembly, regarding to the problem, the global problem, especially in the pandemic, he said that now in current day, yes, no one is safe. No is everybody, everyone is. So we have to cooperation, so everybody will be safe from the pandemic. No one left behind. So everybody is will be safe. Thank you all of you, and safe and healthy.
Thank you, Paiko. That concludes our session for today, but we need some kind of document, and the only way to do it is if we all turn on our camera so we can have everyone be in the picture. So we need to unpin everyone here. Can you unpin everyone, Hadi, while I take the picture?
Yes.
So semuanya mohon untuk membuka kamera supaya bisa muncul ya di foto, di dokumen yang kita lakukan. I see you are now having some, Pak Rozi is having time with the children. Okay. There are 10 frames, so I will start now with the first frame. Please bear with me. Okay, frame number one. Okay, and then I am going to go to frame number two.
Sebentar ya, Bu.
Okay. Siap, saya ke frame number two. It's time to copy paste. Okay, I'm now going to frame number three. I'm happy that all the students here are attend, and this is something that's new and trendy, I guess, in a way. Makes it more interesting for them.
Yeah, and the students has really great questions, all of them. I read it in the chat room, and I really proud of you because you enjoy the discussion and contribute to the discussions.
Yes, I'm now on screen number five. Apologies, please give me some time. Halfway through. Okay, five, we don't have anyone on camera, but I will just take it. I can see your name. Okay, I'm now in screen number six. I'm now in screen number seven. It's quite tedious work. I need AI to help me do this. Okay, and then I will be now in the next slide, which is number eight. And then I'm now in slide nine. For those who are waiting, maybe you can also fill in the feedback form, which will also provide you the certificate for attending. Okay, now I'm into the last slide. Okay, and I'm done. So thank you again, everyone, for joining. And please do not forget to fill in the feedback form. We will try our best to answer the questions that were not answered. And the presenters today have actually share their presentation that you can download. Thank you again, everyone. Have a good evening and hopefully to be able to see you in October during the 6th ICOMEC 2021. Goodbye.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
Prof. Petrius.
Thank you. Merci.
Thank you.
Really nice to have you all. And well, we have like 300 participants and more, actually.
Yeah.
Thank you.
People are going out now. Yeah. Have a great day and see you soon.
You too. Merci beaucoup.
Merci
beaucoup.
Bye.
Au revoir.
Au revoir. Merci beaucoup.
Merci beaucoup.
Thank you very much.
Bye.